Greetings, unsettled souls. Go! Welcome to the correct news. Sam might be the manager and political commentary for the media speaks. You can also find me at the conservative Daily Post, where I'm a writer as well as blasting news. And of course, I've been the band passing time. Guys, it's the Dunce Cap of the Month award show. The part that you're absolutely waiting for the most. The Who is the Dumbest Person of the Month award. Well, we've got a bunch, and they get dumber as we go all the way through it. But I found that when I do that, not as many people listen to the whole show, because they skip right to the absolute dumbest. So what I have done is I have mixed up my dummies for everyone. So not all of the absolute dummies, not all of the absolute most stupid are at the end. So I'm going to make sure my volumes are set well for everyone, and we're going to get on. Once again, it doesn't necessarily go in order, as in this example. Mark Dice, I'm not going to play the whole thing, just see his video. YouTube cancels new album because Trump won. YouTube hasn't made a good album since the dawn of time and the creation of the sun, so it hardly matters. There's like three chords. The only thing about Edge that makes YouTube cool at all is the fact that Edge uses a bunch of really cool effects on his guitar that most people don't have. And he has an odd way of playing those effects. Other than that, I really don't think anybody cares about whether or not YouTube is doing it. But I think it's funny that they came out and two of them, or three of them, went to these Christian academies and locked themselves away. The atheist member in the band thought they'd all gone insane. And ever since then, they've come out in favor of every anti-American, every single restrictive, overly, another way to put it, censorship. They don't want the left to the right to have any say. They want everything to only be their way. And if they don't get it, they're not going to make your CD. But guess what, jerk, we weren't going to buy it anyway. CBS5AZ.com, student workers not part of minimum wage increase. Now, you can say a lot of things about whether or not the minimum wage is needed, whether it's a good idea, whether it's a bad idea. We can have that discussion. But if we are going to have the minimum wage, then doesn't it stand to reason that nobody needs the minimum wage more than students? Arizona State University labor manager said student workers won't get a minimum wage increase. The email sent out to the employees said they are classified as state workers that are exempt from Prop 206 and won't see that $10 per hour wage. Students like having jobs on campus due to the convenience and their expenses have increased. But their expenses have increased. A number of businesses around campus have increased menu prices to pay for the mandated wage hike. Now, see, this is one of the ways. This is one of the reasons I said that the minimum wage is a bad idea. Now, what they're doing to these students should be absolutely thrown out the window. Every other state employee gets a lot more than $10 an hour, so I think the students should too. Second of all, this is what minimum wage does. A number of businesses around campus have increased menu prices to pay for the mandated wage hike. In other words, minimum wage went up, but the price of everything else went up. So it didn't help anyone anywhere. And then when, of course, the state decides to move in and be unfair and mess up an entire block of people just because they're students, then, of course, you can even see more holes in the minimum wage problem. So there are better ways to handle it. But if you're going to, if you're going to do it this way, maybe you should at least make sure that kids, students, not even just kids anymore, have access to something they can afford to live on while they're trying to get their way through school. For student workers who won't have an extra dollar or two in their pocket, they said it's a big deal. We're all college students. We're living paycheck to paycheck. I know I am personally. Every month, it's like I'm going to have enough money for groceries or whatever. Well, you know what? There were times when I was in school I didn't, so I understand that. Full-time student Joseph Priest has left campus job and now gets $10 an hour to bag groceries. So now what you're going to get is the best and the brightest no longer working at the college because the state is screwing them out of the money that is rightfully theirs. If you didn't want to pay it, then maybe, just maybe, as a whole, Maybe we should have elected people that weren't in favor of outsourcing so that there were more good jobs for people to have. Why are our colleges overflowing? Why is everybody trying to get in? Because a lot of the tasks that pay decently that were in this country were allowed to be outsourced. We're allowed to do things that thankfully Trump is stopping. And that's why there are no jobs for everyone. So anyone's trying to go into college, and college usually costs far more than it's worth. I went, I'm glad I went, but I mean, it was an awful lot of work that, for a lot of jobs that weren't there, like graphics and communications and internet design and music production and things that I majored in. I'm currently a journalist, and I use a lot of what I've learned in school at it, but I'm not sure that there are things I couldn't have learned by myself. But that's the way the system is rigged, you see, because if you learn it by yourself, it's almost as if suddenly the knowledge doesn't count. It only counts if you paid a fortune that you didn't have in order to get the piece of paper. Friends, this is Daily Caller, whom Nancy Pelosi caught on hot mic. Tell them you're a Muslim. Now, Nancy Pelosi is one of the most vile people in the entire political landscape. So this should come as a surprise to nobody, but a hot microphone picked up Minority Leader Nancy Pelosi instructing a Democratic congressman to tell the crowd of anti-Trump protesters that he was Muslim. Pelosi's slip-up took place in front of a group of protesters demonstrating outside the Supreme Court against Donald Trump's executive order on immigration. Listen to this. 31 seconds long.
Now we'll hear from Andre Carson, a Muslim member of Congress.
Greetings from the great state of Indiana. I'm Congressman Andre Carson. Not only do I represent Indiana's 7th Congressional District very proud.
Do you see her? Make sure you know. We can't be Americans. We can't be white Americans. We have to be white Americans, I mean. We have to be black Americans. We have to be Asian or women Americans, female Americans. We can't be just Americans. Not in Pelosi's world. Pelosi cited the microphone to, ceded the microphone to Indiana Rep. Andre Carson, whom she instructed as a Muslim, introduced as a Muslim member of Congress. Greetings from the state of Indiana. I'm Congressman Andre Carson. And there was, of course, Pelosi badgering him. Tell him you're a Muslim, she mumbled. Tell him you're a Muslim. Carson complied. Not only do I represent Indiana's 7th Congressional District very proudly, but I happen to be a Muslim and a former police officer. Again, tell him you're Muslim, tell him you're Muslim, tell him you're Muslim. Who cares? He's not blowing people up. Trump is stopping the people who are blowing people up. So Nancy Pelosi, go to hell! Check this out. Pope Francis compares Donald Trump to Hitler. Now, Pope Francis is somebody who has completely destroyed the tenets of the Christian faith. He is somebody who has encouraged the very new world order that the Bible warns against. He has encouraged it as a good idea. Well, it goes on. We've got here going to screen share. He gets worse and worse when you think he couldn't. Pope Francis warned against populist leaders, saying that Germany came to elect one in 1933 and ended up with Adolf Hitler as its dictator. People are forgetting that in many regards, JFK was a populist. Was JFK like Hitler? Or did you kill him because he was absolutely nothing like Hitler? Which is probably a lot more close to what actually happened. One bad populist does not make every populist bad. Crisis provoke fear, alarm. In my opinion, most common example of European populism is Germany in 1933. No, the look at populism was very likely JFK. A people that was immersed in a crisis, that looked for its identity until this charismatic leader came and promised to give them their identity back. And gave them a distorted identity. We all know what happened. No, you know, but here's what's frightening, and people don't realize this. I had this conversation with Christelle earlier. Just because Hitler was unbelievably wrong in the fact that he was a fascist and not a libertarian, the term wasn't around then, but you know what I mean, wasn't freedom-minded. The fact that Adolf Hitler was a despicable person when it came to the way he treated Jews and treated minorities, he did not give them a distorted view of who they are by putting them first. He gave them a distorted view of who they are by making them think that their DNA was better than everyone else's. Every nation has the right to put their nation first. Otherwise, other nations will constantly look to take advantage of them in the same way they do during a war. It'll just be a war without bloodshed. Think, people, think. Hitler did not steal power. The Pope said he was elected by his people and then he destroyed his people. He was kind of elected. He did steal his position in Parliament when the other leader died, so that's not entirely true. Because, of course, they have joint leadership in Germany. So he did take it. In times of crisis, we lack judgment, and that is a constant reference for me. That is why I always try to say, talk amongst yourselves, talk to one another. Yeah, we have talked about ourselves. We said that we don't want refugees, that we don't know who they are, that have not been vetted, coming into the country and raping our women. We have talked amongst ourselves and we have decided that your calls for a new world order and a one world currency are absolutely corrupt. We have talked about ourselves, as a matter of fact, and come to the conclusion that you're the worst pope of all time. Jerk. Pope Francis was talking to the newspaper as Donald Trump was sworn into the new president in Washington, D.C. Some critics say Trump has authoritarian leanings, which he does not. The Pope said that he would not jump to conclusions on Trump. Well, he just did. And will observe his actions before passing judgment, after comparing him to Hitler. We will see how he acts, what he does, and then I will have an opinion. But being afraid or reinforcing beforehand because of something that might happen, in my view, is quite unwise. Look, Pope isn't going to like him, because Trump is against one world government shenanigans. Trump is against things that are going to bring us into a system that is going to destroy us. And he's for the American people, which is why people in the New World Order, including the Pope, hate him. Friends, brought to you by Bovoda. If you're going to gamble, gamble at Bovoda. I did, and you know what? I had some problems with the check, and they fixed it up immediately. Cost zero. Now that's customer service. Steve Watson, Prison Planet, Washington Post columnist, compares Trump's stock market bump to Nazi Germany. Now, if every time that something goes well for the nation, we're like Nazi Germany. I love it. If the economy flourishes, well, you know the economy flourishes under Hitler. You know, the economy flourished under Hitler, and then he decided to try to start attacking everyone, and lost the war, and lost his mind, and if that sounds like anyone, it sounds like Barack Obama, who was the one who was out attacking everybody. Donald Trump has attacked only one target, the target that he said he would attack, and that is ISIS. A columnist at the Washington Post has all the answers as to exactly why the U.S. stock market is through the roof following Donald Trump entering the White House. It's because Nazi Germany. As the Dow Jones Industrial Average surpassed 20,000 points, an all-time high, and the second fastest run to a significant milestone in history, which means the economy is doing better than ever before, Post writer Anne Applebaum, again, it's on fiat money, so it's not sound, seriously compared the surge in the stock market to the rise of Hitler, because everything that happens must be like Hitler. In Nazi Germany, the stock market rose and kept rising, right up to Stalingrad, Applebaum tweeted. Well, guess what? There's nothing wrong with a country prospering. Nothing wrong at all. Nothing. Not even if you're taking over other nations, like Hitler was. I don't see Trump doing that. Nothing wrong with a nation flourishing. Nothing at all. Applebaum herself, staunch anti-Trump ally, has previously penned columns suggesting that the president is really a Russian oligarch. All right, well, the Russians were die-hard communists, and the Nazis were fascist communists, socialists. So, which side is it you're saying they're on? Or is he both? He's Stalin and he's Hitler. I see. A nice trick, by the way, dumbass. Financial experts have attributed the rise of the stock market to Trump's election last week, which is true. The New York Stock Exchange Group President Tom Farley joked on CNBC that we know that if you talked about lowering corporate income taxes and smarting regulation, that maybe we'd see a pickup in the markets and animal spirits. Farley notes that Trump's financial policies have already been and that 2017 will be a good year. And that's what the left is terrified of, friends. They're absolutely terrified of the fact that it really does look like President Trump is going to make America not only great again, but going to make it prosperous again. And it looks like he's going to head and going to go and be an overwhelming success. And that is something that the left fears even more, because then they know not only will they have been proven wrong, but they will have very little chance of ever getting the White House back to any memorable degree. And just absolutely hilarious. This here, a Cleveland Cavaliers star LeBron James calls Donald Trump voters goofy. Yeah, you mean goofy like when you had the entire team made up around you and you couldn't win the sausage, so you took your t-shirt off, you took your jersey off, threw it, blamed the coach for the team that he let you build, and then went to another city, then came crawling back here with your tail between your legs because you missed your family? Look, you're a charitable man, you're a good man, but on a political spectrum and in terms of professionality, you are a jerk and you should be kicked. Following the Cleveland Cavaliers Friday morning shoot-around, don't really kick him, he just should be, star forward LeBron James called President Donald J. Trump's voters goofy during questions of the media. After the shoot-around, the media asked James what he thinks about the controversy over this year's All-Star Game voting. James seemed to blow off any concerns over the goofy voting by saying that there's always controversies over voting, but he slammed over 62 million voters in the process. People who, 62 million of which, hopefully won't buy your overpriced garbage, your shoes, your jersey, your hat, whatever. There's always goofy votes. Donald Trump is our president. James is an outspoken supporter of Hillary Clinton because he doesn't care about the black community, I guess, during the late presidential contest and has attacked President Trump in the past. In fact, when asked if he could visit Trump at the White House, James was wary of the idea, saying, "I don't know, that's something I would cross. We'll have to cross that road, I guess. We'll see. I would love to cross that road." Yeah, right. You know what? If he's smart, he won't let you even drive by the White House. I'm dead serious. At this point, he wouldn't even contemplate letting you drive by. Moving on. Zero Hedge. California Governor Jerry Brown admits to a $1.5 billion error in a state budget. Now, you know, we all make math errors. You make math errors. I make math errors. It took me a couple times to pass algebra trig. I get it. You should be fired for this, you moron. Absolute incompetence. Fired. Out the door. See you later. You suck. This is from Tyler Durden, Zero Hedge. Budgeting can be difficult, particularly for expensive state budgets that require tons of inputs and thousands of line items, each of which can result in massive variances depending on the development of various economic indicators, like interest rates, commodity crises, etc. throughout the year. In other words, the money is not always set in stone and sometimes fluxes based on need. That said, while forecasting variances are inevitable, we as taxpayers generally rely on budget office employees to at least present annual budgets that reflect sound mathematics and accounting principles. Unfortunately, that seems to be too much to ask of the math-challenged administration of California Governor Jerry Brown, who has been in office since the early 80s. He is the Jerry Brown that the Dead Kennedys are singing about in California Uber Alice, which I think came out in like 82 or 84. He is still there, has been there off and on ever since. That Jerry Brown, from the fossil record, decided to double count certain cost savings and simply forgot to incorporate other expenses altogether. Budget staffers said there were two mistakes: a double counting of state savings from a program that coordinates health, behavior, and long-term care services with local government. That was a $913 million error. And a forgotten cost of two counties, San Mateo and Orange, enrolling in the coordinated program, which meant they missed expenses of $573 million. Embarrassingly, California Uber Alice, when asked about the mistakes that resulted in $1.6 billion budget deficit, Chief Deputy Director of Brown's Department of Finance could offer no other explanation. Said that the math is wrong. No, you don't say. No, Jack. math was wrong, while another spokesman admitted there is no other way to describe this other than a straight-up error in accounting, which we deeply forget. Meanwhile, adding insult to injury, Brown's administration allegedly discovered their accounting errors several months ago, but didn't disclose them to senators until this week. We did not account for the $487 million in rebates from drug makers from the state must pay in federal government to reimburse Washington. So, not only did they make the error, but they tried to hide the error. That's all the hallmarks of all great liars throughout human history, friends. Doctors told not to say expectant mothers to avoid offending trannies. Now, this is more political correctness gone amok. This is more of the absolute garbage from people who refuse to respect and learn what biology teaches us. So since we have to go through the lesson again, everybody put your drinks down, turn the TV down. If you have a member, a schmeckle, between your legs, then you are male. But what if I feel female? You're male, and you feel female. You are confused, but you are male. If you do not have a fifth member between your legs, if there is something that resembles a hole there, then you are in fact female.
But what if I feel like a man?
You're still female, and you feel like a man, and you are confused. If you go to try to add a penis onto you, or if you try to take a penis away from you men, you will not be a man or woman, you will simply be a mutilated man or woman. In other words, if you are a man and you cut your wang off, you are not a female, you are a mutilated man. Same for women, if you get an adenectomy done, you are not a man, you are just a mutilated woman. Well, doctors told not to say expectant mothers. Pregnant people is the preferred nomenclature. Well, not on this show. Doctors have been instructed to refer to mothers as pregnant people to avoid offending transgenders, according to the new guidelines from the British Medical Association. You know, because transgenders can't be bothered with facts. A newly issued 14-page booklet issued by British Medical Association entitled A Guide to Effective Communication, Inclusive Language in the Workplace, calls on doctors to refrain from using the term expectant mother, despite its biological accuracy. The union's advice to doctors comes several weeks after reports that Hayden Cross, a 20-year-old British woman, transitioning to become a man, put gender reassignment surgery on hold to have a baby. There are no other cases of the transitioning person becoming pregnant in the UK out of 775,000 women who gave birth in the UK every year. In other words, instead of telling this person that they needed a psych man, you're wanting to get the hell out of the office, the BMA is capitulating to this idiot. Soon, the doctors won't be allowed to say that cancer is bad because that may offend the patients. They'll just send them home and tell them they're fine. You don't want to offend the cancer either. Despite the minuscule number of pregnant transgenders, the BMA has insisted doctors stop using the word mother when referring to pregnant individuals to celebrate diversity. I don't celebrate diversity. I call it a mental illness. If you don't know if you're male or female, then there's something wrong with you. Now, if you're gay, fine, be gay. But don't try to convince us that you're a sex that you're not. Otherwise, we're going to laugh at you. And if that you tell us we're politically correct, then we're absolutely going to howl. A large majority of people that have been pregnant or gave birth and identify as women. However, there are some intersex men and trans men that may get pregnant. Good. You know what? They're messed in the head and we're not catering to them. We can exclude intersex men and trans men who may get pregnant by saying pregnant people instead of expectant mothers. We can also tell you to go to hell and learn what facts are, you stupid blindside jerk. CNN.com, baby dolphin dies after tourist pulls it out of the water. Now, this was one of the ones, friends, that I really thought was going to get the dunce cap of the month. I mean, this is real close. We're zeroing in here now. For those of you probably leftists who do not know, dolphins die when they're not in the water. In Argentina, an animal dies so that humans can take a picture, and it isn't the first time. Now, yeah, I think a lot of people, because of SeaWorld and things, don't realize that how quickly dolphins can die outside of the water. And if they're not trained, and if they're not used to being out of the water for some time, then it can be a very short amount of time that they're able to remain out. So the question is why? Well, I know why, because I didn't know any better. Can sometimes be answered because humans are selfish, thoughtless half-wits. I would say because they're just dumb. I think they're being a little hard on this idiot, but just the same. The answer may apply to the fact that tourists in the seaside resort of San Bernardo, Argentina, dragged a baby dolphin out of the water so that they could take selfies of it. As Argentina's La Capital resorts, this isn't the work of one or two humans. A whole group of people dragged the dolphin out and surrounded it. The paper quotes a woman called Claudia who said that after the photos were taken and the fun was had, they left it for dead. Alright, well, you know what, maybe they did know. She added that they could have put it back into the water where dolphins are supposed to be. Instead, she said they were more interested in touching it and taking selfies. Video of the incident posted on Twitter shows many beachgoers crowded around the animal and no one seeming to be the slightest concern for its survival. Says it wasn't the first time it happened. Now, see, when this story was originally sent to me, I was told that this was about people taking a selfie with a dolphin. This is a stranded dolphin that they were too stupid to get back into the water. At least you could have taken the picture and thrown it in the water. Last February in Santa Teresita, another seaside Argentinian city, a man dragged a rare Franciscana dolphin out of the water for a similar purpose with a similar result. Humans just can't help wanting to take selfies with animals regardless of the risks to themselves, such as, of course, the bear, and I said, please just stop. Well, you know what? People are stupid. And they're stupid largely because of the people that we put in office and the kinds of culture that we promote. So don't blame them. Not completely. Breitbart.com. A fisherman faces life in prison for catching $500,000 worth of cocaine and selling it. My story here is that, friends, if you ever catch $500,000 worth of cocaine, you might want to figure out how to move it without, you know, alerting everyone. If you have no experience in selling cocaine, then you may not want to do it. You may even, if you're of the honest persuasion, want to turn it in. Never been a fan of the white stuff myself. Tried it once. Absolutely hated it. But I'm against the war on drugs. I think it's up to each person what they put into their own body. It's not up to anybody else. However, this guy gets definite mention here on the Dunce Cap of the Month Awards show, and you'll see why. A commercial fisherman faces life in prison, now that's a bit much, for catching a 45-pound haul of cocaine and selling it instead of turning it over to authorities. So because he did not capitulate, he will see his life thrown away. That's ridiculous. Thomas Breeding, who must have had some inbreeding perhaps, a 32-year-old boat captain who had a history of drug and weapons convictions, was charged with conspiracy to distribute a controlled substance and unlawfully transporting a firearm. The Panama City News Herald reported. Breeding said that he had never been involved in the drug trade before, and he was just a hard-working young commercial fisherman. Breeding distributed the cocaine to four others who helped him sell the product and then received a cut from the sales. The haul was worth between $50,000 and $620,000. Authorities investigated the scheme and charged all five people involved with conspiracy to distribute a controlled substance. Breeding pleaded guilty to the charges Wednesday. He faces life in prison and a $4.25 million fine. I said, this changed my life, my way of thinking, and also made me aware of the dangers that can be found off the shore of the Gulf. Breeding wrote recently in a letter to the News Herald, well, you know what? We have open borders, so we're going to have people chucking things like that into the water. But I'll tell you what, friends, to take his life away, a life, that's ridiculous. He did not kill anyone. He does not deserve, and taxpayers, for that matter, do not deserve to spend thousands and thousands of dollars to house this particular gentleman. Although, I do think he needs worthy of mention here on the Dunce Cap of the Month show. Only got three stories left. That's it. The three of the dumbest. The Argentinian guy couldn't get it. It was too far away. I didn't know who they were. Didn't say in the article. We got three left. Three absolute idiots left. 30 pounds of cocaine found on American Airlines plane during routine maintenance. Now, this isn't much of a dumdy, except for the fact that the person, whoever the bag screener was, I was going to send it to America Airlines, but I couldn't talk badly about everybody because of the work of one person that was clearly asleep at the wheel. A worker found nearly 30 pounds of cocaine hidden inside an American Airlines plane during a routine maintenance check. They didn't try to sell it, so I guess they're not getting life in prison. This is from Fox 23. Workers found 7 bricks of cocaine inside an electronics bay near the nose gear of a Boeing 737 parked at the American Airlines maintenance base in Tulsa. According to the airline, authorities were immediately contacted. The plane came from Bogota and landed in Miami and got picked up on the computer system for routine maintenance. And usually that happens in Miami, and they were overloaded, and that's how it got here, said Mike Moore of the Tulsa County Sheriff's Office. According to the Sheriff's Office, a total weight of roughly 26 pounds for an additional 4 pounds of packing material. And American Airlines has launched an investigation. Yeah, I bet they have. All right, guys, the runner-up for the dumb D of the day, the absolute runner-up, my on-screen share grid, from the mirror.co.uk, man says his 18.9-inch penis is a disability that forces him to live off food banks. However, he wants to rely on state benefits and not have the schmeckle shortened. Now, personally, I think the man should probably get into porn or modeling and quit showing his schmeckle to people for free, which is what he's doing. And he would probably have all the money he'd need for the rest of his life. If not, it is not the government's job to pay for him when he doesn't want to have the surgery done. If I had 18.9 inches, yeah, I'm about 0.9 inches short, but you know. If I had 18.9 inches, I probably would leave it too. But I would not be trying to live off the government dole. You would simply see me on the front of every X-rated box from here to Zimbabwe. The man with the world's largest penis has claimed the size of his manhood is a disability that forces him to live off food banks. Roberto Esquivel Cabrera said his 18.9-inch penis stopped him from working and left him reliant on state benefits. But the 54-year-old from Saltillo, Mexico, has turned down size reduction and prefers fame to sex. He made headlines worldwide in 2015 after the video went viral showing him weighing his manhood to prove its authenticity. His half-meter penis smashed the record previously believed to belong to actor John Falcon, whose penis was 9.5 inches flaccid and 13.5 when erect. Speaking to Barcroft on TV, he said, "I'm famous because I have the largest penis in the world." Yeah, you're also an idiot. Moore, 44, born without penis, was a bionic manhood fitting those to lose their virginity. That's, of course, the other man that was recently fitted with one. "I am happy with my penis, but nobody has this size I have. I would like to be in the Guinness Book of World Records, but they don't recognize the record yet because it's fake." But despite his pride, members of the medical community have urged him to at least consider a penis reduction. Dr. Jesus David Salazar Gonzalez said, "We have advised him, Mr. Roberto, the best thing that you can do is that the doctors give you a normal shape to your penis so that it doesn't hurt you in order to have sexual relationships and in order to have children." But he doesn't accept it. He'd rather have a bigger penis than the rest of the people because he's an idiot. That's why he's being mentioned as runner-up for the dumb D of the day. In Latin culture, whoever has the biggest penis is more macho. Never mind the fact, of course, that you can't have sex. It's something that makes him different from the rest of the people and makes him feel special because he's an idiot with no talents otherwise. Doctors have been able to offer some insight into how his penis became so large, but they have been stretching his penis by weights since he was a teenager. So he's been artificially doing it. He was obsessed with penis length. He began his enlargement since he was a teenager, wrapping some bands around his penis with some weights and trying to stretch it. So there's a picture of it, of course, on the x-ray. There you go. As you can see, all he's done, as in right there, is destroy his penis. The sheer size of his penis causes a number of health problems, including frequent urinary tract infections, because not all of his urine escapes the lengthy foreskin, and it keeps his colossal member wrapped in bandages to escape chafing. In other words, he's literally jeopardizing his life with stale urine in his urethra. He was unable to sleep chest down and has to put his penis on a pillow to escape discomfort during the night. An active sex life is off limits because his penis has too much girth to have intercourse. Some people ask me if I put condoms on, and the answer is I cannot. I can never penetrate anyone because it is too thick. I mean, learn to push. I don't know. While living in the USA, Roberto did attempt to have sex twice, but the first woman backed out as soon as she saw his penis, and the other one had to stop because it was too painful. Roberto says it's a disability and stops him from working. Well, you're the one who did it, dumbass. He cannot wear a uniform like anybody else, so companies cannot. I cannot get on my knees. He cannot run fast, and so companies think badly of me. They think they call me, but they never do. Well, there you go. There it is, in a sock, as it were, hanging almost all the way to his shins because he's an idiot. According to Roberto, after initially dismissing the claim, the government has now recognized him as disabled. Every 4 months, they give me some economic assistance, but it's not enough. I visit food banks and take meals at 12 o'clock. Well, you know what? You are a moron. Speaking of morons, that brings us to the dumb news of the day. Not just that, but the dunce cap of the month. Ringling Brothers closing after the greatest show on earth ran for 146 years. Now, the dumdee here is going to PETA, and I'll tell you why it's going to PETA. Not only have they destroyed an American institution, but they have destroyed an American institution without reason. Animals in most zoos live longer than they do in the wild, and they are happier. There are many, many studies that prove this. It's very easy to look up. Animals that are in the circus, like Ringling Brothers, Barnum and Bailey Circus, or any reputable circus, like the Shrines, are happier, and they live longer, and are more content than elephants in the wild. PETA is somehow blind to this fact, and all they have done is destroy an American institution that was helping, not harming, the animals by having them perform. Now, that is fact. Feel free to argue against that, but that just means that you're wrong and I'm right. That's fine. You're allowed to be wrong. Point is, the animals are much happier, and there has been a lot of studies showing that they live much longer. Because their health is cared for, and they're not dodging predators. Send home the clowns after 100, and this breaks my heart to even read. I remember going to the circus with my family was some of the greatest experience of my life. I still have souvenirs from it. 146 years, the curtain is coming down forever on the greatest show on earth. Ringling Brothers and Barnum and Bailey Circus last performance will be May 21st at the Nassau Coliseum. The showstoppers included high operating costs, declining attendance, and changing public tastes. Not to mention a long and costly battle with animal rights activists, which ended with its hugest stars, the elephants, being pink-slipped. Elephants have been a symbol of the circus since the Asian pachyderm named Jumbo joined them in 1882. Employees were also sad the news last Saturday night in October. The circus will perform 30 more times. Besides the show in Long Island, there will be one in Brooklyn. Other stops of its last tour include Atlanta, Washington, and Boston. With its exotic animals and death-defying acrobats, the Big Top has been a huge draw since the mid-1800s to the mid-1900s. Phineas Taylor Barnum made a traveling spectacle of animals and human oddities popular, while the five Ringling Brothers performed juggling acts and skits. Eventually, they merged into modern circus with Bourne, which remains one of the most amazing shows ever put together by human beings, and it's being destroyed in the gall of political correctness. I really, really hope that in a few years, when Trump is in office, more sane minds will come together and bring this great, great legacy back. Clowns, acrobats, horseback riders, they were transported across the country in special cars on extra-long trains. New York staged its own yearly spectacle when the circus came to town. The performers, along with invited guests, rode elephants from Sunnyside rail yards through the Queens Midtown Tunnel and then along Manhattan streets to Madison Square Garden, back when America still knew what talent was. In its heyday, the circus attracted huge crowds. It had such glamorous images that kids famously dreamed of running away to join them. But as years passed, children grew less enchanted. No, they did not grow less enchanted. What they did was they were programmed to have absolutely no attention span whatsoever and be addicted to a cell phone by a culture that was trying to dumb them down. Wake the hell up. First blockbuster movies, then television, and finally video games and the internet captured the circus's core audience, both the youngsters and their parents. Absolutely untrue. The competitor in many ways is time, said owner Kenneth Feld, adding that transporting the show by rail and other circus quirks, such as providing a traveling school for performing children, are throwbacks to another era, then why don't you continue to bring children in and teach them these things? Why don't you teach young adults these things? Why don't you keep doing what it is that has made you great and refuse to capitulate to political correctness? When the Feld family bought the circus in 1967, the show was just under 3 hours. Today it's 2 hours and 7 minutes, and the longest segment, the tire-rigger act, is only 12 minutes. Try getting a 3-year or 4-year-old to sit still for 12 minutes. Why? I imagine they will if you have a tagger in their face. I'm telling you, man, there's something wrong with this. They're capitulating and they don't want to admit it. I don't know one kid that wouldn't be enthralled, no matter how many video games they play, no matter how many movies they see, that wouldn't be thrilled to go to the circus. The circus brings joy to thousands, if not millions, of kids every year. Feld and his daughter, Julia Feld, who are idiots, the company's chief operating officers, idiots, acknowledged another reality that led to the closing, and it was one that initially drew the show animals. In 2016, they removed elements from the show that sent them to a conservation farm in Central Florida, where they are now miserable. Feld Entertainment won a $25.2 million in settlements from groups including the Humane Society, and in a 14-year-old fight over allegations of circus. So they won the case and they're still stopping. Attendance has been dropping for 10 years. Well, then you need to change the way you're marketing it. Maybe you're marketing it like it was 1967, morons. Why don't you put some big screens up so that people can see it all around? Why don't you add maybe some of the new digital lights? Why don't you do that instead of canceling the Ringling Brothers and Barling and Bailey Circus, you freaking morons? That brings me to let you show what I'm about to send them, and they are going to have this sent to them. This here is the Dunce Cap of the Month award. And here it is for you. Hit pause. There you go. Here's what it says, the Dunce Cap of the Month award. This Dunce Cap of the Month goes without hesitation into the utter dolts and idiots, at PETA, who have shut down the American institution of the Ringling Brothers and Barnum and Bailey Circus. The animals, even the elephants, have been found to be happier and live longer in both that circus and in most zoos of the world, of which PETA hates. Then again, since you kill 95% of the animals that you claim to save, that is true, that is what PETA does, how could anyone expect you to know any facts? Thanks for making the world a more miserable place, and hey, bastards, that's where you can find this show at if you want to see yourself given the Dunce Cap of the Month award. Here is the Dunce Cap that they are going to be sent. There is an elephant. Where is my elephant? There is an elephant. And the elephant is saying, us elephants live longer in a circus than in the wild. Thanks. PETA sucks. Here is my lady on the flying trapeze. I'm quite sad. There's my elephant and my lady on the trapeze. She is saying, another American loss as PETA lies close a death-defying tradition. PETA sucks. And last but not least, my very disgruntled and sad clown. Well, I guess I got one other thing on here. Hold on. Nice job, PETA. You bozos got an American institution that made millions of often sick children happy close. PETA sucks. And then, of course, F you, PETA! From the circus tent that I drew here. And all of that is going to be sent to PETA. Just like this. Going to be sent in the mail. And that friend is the Dunce Cap of the Month award show. I had sent dunce caps to the White House. I sent it to the FBI. I'd sent them wherever they need to go. I'd sent them to the Pentagon. I'd sent them to judges. I'd sent them to police stations. I'd sent them to individuals. I'd sent them to Beyonce. Listen, if you support someone like me who's not afraid to put it out there, then do me a favor and please support this show. You can do so by going down on Patreon and donating, or you can donate directly at thecorrectviews@hotmail.com. I'll let you know where to send any money. For that matter, you can send money to thecorrectviews@hotmail.com on PayPal. The money that you give to me, I put towards a better show, which is something that's very important to me. I'd like to give that to you. Good night, friends. Thank you for listening, and God bless.